Ladies and gentlemen, can I please have your attention? Stop what you're doing and listen.
DOD45. Already we find ourselves at episode 75 of the DOD45 show. I'm shocked we've gone this far, and I'm thankful, good to be thankful, on our Thanksgiving episode. I'm thankful for our guest this week, former UPW and WWE wrestler, head instructor at Ultimate University, K101 and Pride Fighter, actor and significant other to WWE Raw star and NXT Tag Team Champion, Zoey Stark. All these accolades, and he happens to be my cousin, it is Tom Howard. We have such a great conversation with Tom. He's got some of the greatest stories, and he doesn't shy away from sharing them with us on this Thanksgiving episode where I draw him a detailed hand turkey. You know those hand turkeys we used to draw in elementary? Well, since this episode drops on the eve of Thanksgiving, y'all should gather around the TV with pens and paper, draw along, and listen to our discussion while Tom recalls his experiences with training legendary wrestlers like John Cena and Samoa Joe, his MMA match with the Korean Colossus, getting in the ring with Eric Butterbean, training Jack Black on the set of Nacho Libre, fighting former WWE wrestler and Australian actor Nathan Jones on the set of Ong Bak franchise film The Muay Thai Giant. Smiles and stories aplenty, plus heaps of Tom mentions, including Tom Hardy, Tom Hanks, Tom Green, Tom Selleck, Tommy Lee Jones, Tom Cruise, Tom Brady, and Tom Terrific Seaver. It's our Thanksgiving episode, and in the following intro discussion between myself and Adrian, I give thanks to people who've helped keep the DOD45 show going. I'm thankful to you as the audience, and I'll take this opportunity to tell you to check out Vast Air of Cannibal Ox's latest releases produced by Liquid Nails on Thanksgiving Day. Why, you ask? Because I did the artwork that you've been seeing posted on social media. That's why. So speed up the process of shoving the stuffing up the turkey, put the pumpkin pie in the fridge, shave the heels of your feet, loosen up that belt, and get ready for this Wednesday, episode 75 of the DOD45 show with Tom Howard. Peace.
DOD45.
Happy Thanksgiving, y'all. Tonight, it's our Thanksgiving episode, and thanks to you, Adrian, for your big idea. We're going to be having a chat with Tom Howard, my cousin, and somebody that you're going to want to stick around to hear from.
And he just happens to be your cousin.
He just happens to be my cousin. What do you mean?
Like, hey, everybody, let's just chat with my cousin.
Right. No, that's what I was saying.
A name for himself.
Yeah, he's led a pretty exciting existence. And being that one of our staple questions on this show is, who is your favorite professional wrestler? Tom's a great guest because he's got genuine insight into that world. But before we do that, since this is a Thanksgiving episode, I'll do a quick few things I'm thankful for. Nothing too cheesy, just some shout-outs. That have to do with our show, so I'm not going to go on a long, like, thanks, Mom and Dad, yada, yada, yada. The first thank you is to Adrian, to you, for being the enabler on this show. Since this isn't really a show you...
signed up for?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you're quite a team player to...
I sure am.
...show up and stick around for it. But yes, thank you, Adrian. I genuinely appreciate it. And I'm sure the audience, our regular audience, appreciate it too.
I'm sure they do.
Well, yeah, because without your enablingness and being willing to do it, probably wouldn't happen. So
I'm actually not enabling it.
Oh, well.
I have been against it the whole time.
I know, but then every time I'm like, well, you don't have to do it anymore.
When did you say that? I tried to quit 5 times.
Oh, all right. Well, people don't want to hear that. you can.
You don't let me.
I don't want you to. I like to have conversations with you. Also, thanks to our audience who continue to watch the show and share it with the others. Thank you to Sage Francis. He was our first guest, and thank you to him for that. And thank you for his continued support on and being a part of the show. I also want to give thanks to Mr. Dibbs for his continued involvement with our show and for reaching out to me after our first recording with Atmosphere.
I think they call it now Giving Flowers.
Oh, Giving Flowers? I don't want to do that. I don't like that. I don't like the Giving Flowers. Good. Can you let's try it this way. And I'd like to give flowers to Mr. Dibs for. but yeah, the atmosphere episode, he called me right after, and then
I don't know why you guys decided it was a dumpster fire. I thought it was fine. I thought it was good. Dumpster fire means it's bad.
Does it? Because I feel like dumpster fire means, and what you're talking about, just for context, is that's how what we were calling the last episode with Mr. Dibs and Brett Fullerton. But when I think of dumpster fire, I think like a train wreck as well.
That's never a good thing.
No, but you have to watch. It's like enthralling. Well, I don't really know.
Okay.
When I think of dumpster fire, I think a lot of
you were saying, but you guys just mentioned that. I overheard him on the phone with you, and you both said, "Oh, dumpster fire." I didn't think so.
Yeah,
a dumpster fire. Turned out okay.
It was one of my favorite episodes. I think it was a lot of people's favorites.
I had nightmares after that episode after looking up all those pictures.
Well, okay. Yeah, I don't know. I guess maybe I misused the term dumpster fire. I don't know. Anyway, so after Dibs called me after that first episode, that was 3 years ago, that episode with Atmosphere.
Oh, that episode.
Yeah, that's what I was talking about. He called me right after that episode.
And you guys have been on speed dial
and to each other. We formed a friendship that I'm happy about. Yeah, it's been fun.
You don't like it when I call him your boyfriend?
No, it's silly. I'm not. Yeah, it's
who's
just
that
silly.
On the phone with? Oh, his boyfriend.
Yeah, that's silly. I don't know. I don't know. That's like, anyway. Also, thanks to Alexander Brown. He reached out to me initially to design the Glow Kid album cover. And I think that was really the start of my initiation into the Strange Famous Family. So, yeah, and I don't think that was even approved of for album cover. I think he just reached out to me to do his album cover, and then.
Well, that's what an artist should do, though.
Yeah, but I mean, it was on the Strange Famous record label, so usually you have to clear things with the label, and I don't know that anything there. I just don't think initially. I don't think it was cleared with the label, and they kind of found out. Oh, I guess. This guy Ty's doing the label, and then now we're your friends with Strange Famous Records and all the family there. So, I also want to give big thanks to everyone in the Strange Famous family, and let me hand you some flowers, and thanks to all the past guests, and even more thanks to the guests who've continued to remain friendly to us, because a lot of guests just come on and never hear from them again. And that's fine. I don't expect it, but I want to give even bigger thanks to those guests who've continued their friendships with us. How about you? You have any thanks you want to give? I know I asked you about that the other night, and you're like, I'm not.
I'm not thankful for anything.
You just don't want to do that.
I'm good.
Okay.
I'll pass.
All right. Well, we'll go into a few things, but also I did want to say that I have been pretty down on social media recently.
About time.
Yeah, I don't know what the hell's going on. I'll open it to see if I have messages, because I do a lot of my messaging through there, and I'm just like, I don't even want to be in this. Oh yeah,
I know, it's crap.
Yeah, I don't know. It's I like to see what everybody's up to, and
if you can,
if you can. That's the problem. It's like become like now it's like all these ads, suggested posts. I know I can snooze the suggested posts, but
it seems like it doesn't actually snooze them for 30 days, or 30 days goes by way fast.
Yeah. And I'm seeing a lot of just boring posts from I don't know. I don't even like going in there.
That's all I do is post boring things.
Well, then you're one of the ones that I hate seeing your posts. Just kidding.
I only post, here's a river. Here's a leaf.
Yeah, but see,
there's a bug.
And that's different. That's yours is your yours is a personal page for your family and friends.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't mind that, but yeah, I don't know. It's not even just that. Yeah, it's just like a constant. I don't know. It's just really, I've been quite down on it for the last couple of weeks. So I don't know. This morning I thought, you know what, maybe I'll just go away from it for a while. I've heard people do that. It's not like I'm addicted. I'm not addicted to it at all anyway. I just get on there and post things about ArtByTai, but yeah, I don't know. It's just been
that's what you call a dumpster fire.
Yeah, that's true. But that's what I mean. That's what a dumpster fire is. You can't look away. Like, it's just all kinds of shit happening. And you, you're like, can't look away. Yeah, all right. Well, on the lighter side, something I'm really excited about, the movie The Fall Guy. I've mentioned it on the podcast quite a bit, but yeah, The Fall Guy was one of my favorite TV shows of all time. And it starred Colt...
Sounds clumsy.
Colt Seavers. Well, what, the movie, Fall Guy?
Yeah.
It's he's a stuntman.
He falls all day.
No, well, yeah, because he falls for his job. He's a stuntman. But yet, one time when we were making my very first movie Twice Today, I'll keep this short, but we were trying to get Colt Seavers to be in it. And his name's not Colt Seavers. Shit, that's his... Is that his name in The Fall Guy? Yeah, what's his real name? Oh, man.
I'd help you. I don't know who you're talking about.
Oh, my gosh. Google... Well, no, that's all right. That's not even something I was going to get into. But yeah, Fall Guy movie. I'm looking forward to that. That's got...
Oh, it's a movie from a TV show.
It was a TV show when I was a little kid. It was out with the A-Team. It was like the A-Team, and he drove a big truck, and it was just like Knight Rider.
That might be good.
Well, guess who's going to be in it? That guy, that really pretty dude. Ryan...
Seacrest?
Gosling.
Oh.
It's Ryan Gosling and then that real pretty...
Okay, I'll watch it.
Emily Blunt. Yeah. I mean, it's going to be probably pretty silly and shitty, but also really great. So, anyway. All right, okay, speaking of movies, let me do my movie share real quick.
Oh, that wasn't it?
Uh-uh. This movie share is, because this is our Thanksgiving episode, this is a movie, it's the 1995 movie called Home for the Holidays. I watch it every single year. It's directed by Jodie Foster, and it's got
a
great cast. Yeah, Holly Hunter goes back. She plays the main character. She goes back home to her home in Baltimore with her family. She's from Chicago, but she flies back home for Thanksgiving for a holiday dinner which with her dysfunctional family, and dysfunctional with a capital D.
I don't know. It seems pretty much
That's true, because, yeah, I started learning how the dysfunction is quite normal. But, yeah, if you have any inkling of dysfunction in your family, I don't know how you could watch this movie and not get a kick out of it. Because it's, yeah, you can go like, oh, that's my aunt so-and-so, or that's my... Mm-hmm. Claire Danes plays Holly Hunter's daughter. Steven Guttenberg's in it. Do you know who Steve Guttenberg is?
He's Sly.
No, he was the main guy in Police Academy. Steve Guttenberg.
The white guy?
Yeah, he's... He plays her douchey brother-in-law in the movie. Yeah. And then her aunt's played by this actress, Geraldine Chaplin. And she's kooky. Her parents are played by Charles Durning, who's awesome. And Anne Bancroft is her mom. Those guys are great in it. It's a really endearing kind of movie.
It's kind of cool that it's really the funny. Kooky aunt instead of the kooky uncle.
Uncle? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, she's got a kook. Well, her brother... who plays her brother? Oh, Robert Downey Jr. Yeah. plays her gay brother. And then her love interest is played by, what is that dude's name? Matthew McDermott. Matthew McDermott? Is that, yeah, shit. It doesn't matter. I think you should go watch it. It's a great holiday show. And like I said, we watch it every year. It's really funny. And it never gets old to me.
No, that one is one that doesn't get old, oddly enough.
Yeah, everyone's performances are great, and it's a really
good movie. You know what's so good about a holiday movie like that?
Yeah.
Is that it's predictable, and it's not, you don't have to answer for it. Your kooky relatives in real life, you can just watch it on the screen.
Yeah.
You don't actually have to be there in real life.
Well, and Jodie Foster's no slouch, so she's been in the business forever, so... I mean, she directed that in 1995. Anyway, all right, here's my song share. This is a little bit different. We have never on the show asked for submissions ever. But I do like the initiative that people take. So people have been sending us their music.
Oh.
Yeah. And I'm a sucker for
where?
It. Through the DOD45.com website. Mm. People have been submitting it to the email. Yeah. Yeah. Ty@DOD45.com, I think, is what... Well, there anything that goes to DOD45.com, but...
Butthole.
No. So anyway, I'm a sucker for anyone who's created something from nothing. And also, I know what the feeling is like reaching out to people to ask them to be a part of like whatever you're promoting. I haven't had to do that much with my art recently just because of where we've gotten in my career. But with this show, I found myself back in that world of kind of reaching out to people, trying to get guests, you know, doing all that shit. It's a grind and it's never fun. It's also kind of leaves you, it's like a vulnerable situation. Because you're putting yourself out there and you never know if anyone even sees your messages or emails. And so anyway, I'm empathetic to that. And I got a couple of these submissions a few weeks ago, and I wasn't sure what I was going to do with them. I was probably just going to say, oh, thanks for sending, or I wasn't even going to say anything. But recently I just thought, you know what? I'm going to see if I can do something with those. Any hint of progress when you're in a situation like that, when you're reaching out to people like, hey, listen to my music, or here's this, any sort of progress that you get from that, from reaching out to people, feels great. So I want to feed into these people's grind and their aspirations. We're nobody, but it still feels good to get a shout out from nobody. So here are a few people who submitted their music to us. I say check them out. It may be something you're into. I don't vouch for any of them. They're just songs that showed up.
Rude.
Well, I'm not gonna, I don't know. What if they're, you know, like so-and-so murdered, whatever, you know, I don't vouch for them as people or who they are. Not vouch. Maybe that was the wrong word. I don't know much about them. They submitted their music to us and I feel like I'll share it with you. If it's something you like, then you can dig deeper into them. The first song is from a guy named Vincent Shackelford, AKA Lyrical, and his latest song that is titled It's Still There featuring Dedrick. We'll play you a little bit of it and then you can go into there if it's something you like.
I'm trying to heal from this trauma and the pain that I feel inside, but it's like it's never gonna change.
Pain in my heart and it's hard to explain. People see the fame but they don't know my pain. I'm trying to heal but it's hard to sustain. Living with this pain, man, it's driving me insane. Lost myself, it's hard to deal with the loss. Sometimes feels
very R&B.
I was telling Nale that I was going to do this morning, and I was, Nale's our daughter, and I was thinking, well, I will just say, like, these songs, they're not typically the my genre of music that I listen to, but that doesn't matter. I'm very stuck on my underground hip-hop music and stuff like that. But it might be something that you're into. But I was telling her I was going to say that, and she's like, well, you don't even need to say that. What do you think?
Keep going.
Okay. Then there's this the South African hip hop artist E Random, E period Random. It's like one word, I think. E Random. His music was sent to us by Legit Music Group, and here's a track called Deja Vu, or no, this track called Deja V.
All night, I be wanting you all night.
Shawty back up. It's your figure, it's a pillar. Come and ride up, be my, be my. You know, say me, I want you, baby, forever. Shawty back up. It's your figure, it's a killer. Come and ride up, be my. You know, say me, I want.
And then the last one is from Aboriginal, Indigenous, American Indian recording artist, singer, songwriter, producer, business owner, entrepreneur, mental, whoa, spiritual health advocate, named Ian Christ
in
Australia.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's an Aborigine and Native American.
Aboriginal, Indigenous, American, Indian recording artist. Yeah.
Wow.
His name is Ian Christ, I-A-N Christ. And this track is called Devil's Advocate. On November 6, 2023, Devil's Advocate officially hit number one on the iTunes worldwide chart in the United Kingdom. So here's his track, Devil's Advocate.
Cool.
Yeah, pretty cool that people are sending us music. So yeah, check those out if you'd like, whatever. I appreciate the fact that they've made their music and that they shared it with us. So thank you guys for sharing your music with us. I don't want to open floodgates for that really, but I guess because I like to discover music on my own. But I guess if you,
well, maybe you will, maybe you'll share it, maybe you'll share it, maybe you won't.
Yeah, there you go. All right, and then real quick, a quote Logic is not an applicable tactic against an individual who identifies as anti-anything. So there's a quote. I think that was actually something I wrote down in the...
That's what you say every time.
I know, but this, in my notes, in my phone, I have just quotes. And usually if it was a quote I heard from somebody, I would write in the name, but not always.
So what were you thinking when you wrote that?
Well, I don't want to get into it, but I'm pretty sure that was right in the hype of elections and, you know, things like that. Okay, so what about you? What do you have any song shares, Adrian?
Yeah.
Oh, let's hear it. What do you got?
Well, first of all, I have to say I like Spotify. Not Spotify. SoundCloud's algorithms.
Oh, yeah.
They're so much better than Spotify. But DJ Mayonnaise, or am I supposed to say mayonnaise?
Mayonnaise.
Mayonnaise?
No, I'm just, yeah.
It's mayonnaise. Well, mayonnaise? DJ mayonnaise.
Or DJ Mayo. And you're doing that because in our episode with...
Not, yeah, but
Mestizo.
In my head, I say mayonnaise.
You don't. You, like me, say mayonnaise.
In my head, I say mayonnaise. I don't know how I'm supposed to say it now that Mestizo said we said it weird.
Yeah. Mayonnaise. It's mayonnaise. It's the correct enunciation.
I spell surprise wrong. I don't realize that it's surprise.
You do surprise?
Yeah.
Supper. Okay, continue your track from DJ Mayo, who was an original Anacon producer.
He has this really fun song, and I use it as a timer when I only have an hour. It's an hour long. I really like it, and I think it's older, but it goes through a bunch of artists that I recognize. I'm pretty sure Soul's in there. It's definitely Dose One, Portishead. There's some funky things, some kind of rockish stuff, too. It's called, now I don't know what it's called. It's EP dot. Is that EP or is that episode?
Maybe, yeah.
What does that mean?
Usually EP means episode, unless it's an EP, like the album, like, you know, there's an album, 7-inch, there's an EP, an LP.
But it usually is a capital E, yeah. And then a P. So it's E, capital E, lowercase P,
that's
dot.
Sometimes means
132.
Yeah, episode 132 or
and
something.
And it's,
yeah.
DJ Mayonnaise and Friends.
Nice.
It's on SoundCloud. I don't know that it's on anything else.
Yeah.
But it's really fun, and I use it as a timer to get me. And then I get a little anxiety because I know it's going to end. And then I know my timer's up.
What does this mean?
Well, good. We should have been running that for an hour because I've gone over. Well, let me do a quick intro of Tom in case we don't get to any of them. He's waiting. But all right. So listen, here, this our guest today is Tom Howard. He is my cousin, uncle, because he's older than me. And in Samoan cultures, everyone that's older than you is your uncle or aunt. He's a retired professional wrestler and actor. I'm going to cruise through these real quick because he's in the waiting room.
I know.
He's best known for his Green Beret role in K1 and Pro Wrestling 01 Max in Japan. He was a wrestler instructor with WWF, and in fact, I'm pretty sure he did some training for John Cena. In 1996, he and Rick Bassman formed Ultimate Pro Wrestling, and he was the head instructor for the school Ultimate University, and also began competing in the ring regularly for UPW. I'm pretty sure that's where he trained John Cena and a bunch of other high-profile wrestlers. He was a kickboxing fighter in K1. He was a fighter in Cage Rage and in the thing called IFL. And he did a ton of fighting and wrestling in Japan. He's been an instructor and actor in heaps of movies and is credited as an instructor to Jack Black for his role in Nacho Libre, because in 1995, Tom was recruited to wrestle on television in Mexico, where he became a real popular wrestler, wrestling for Asistencia Asioria y Administración.
We're just chesky when we need it.
I know. As his character was a KGB character. He did that a lot in his wrestling career. Mm-hmm. He lived in Mexico for a couple of years wrestling on the AAA television show. In the 2005 K1 World Grand Prix, he fought a dude named Hong Man Choi, aka the Korean Colossus, who was an absolute giant. And I'm not even exaggerating. I think that guy was 7'2" and was 400 pounds. And Tom's no slouch, but Hong makes him look like a teenager in the ring, like a little kid. It's crazy. Tom gave him a run for his money, and it's a gnarly fight. It's bloody as hell. In 2007, he fought Eric Butterbean in the main event of the World Cage Championship in Jasper, Alabama. Butterbean's a giant man who knocked out Johnny Knoxville in a department store in the first Jackass movie. He's massive. I think at one point Butterbean weighed like 550 pounds when he was fighting in his career. He's done tons of other things. These are just some fun highlights that you could get online and check out through YouTube and stuff. Tom's also been in a long-term relationship with his girlfriend, Teresa, aka Zoey Stark, who's having a huge time in her wrestling career. Mm-hmm. She's currently performing on the Raw, WWE Raw brand. She's a former NXT Women's Tag Team Champion, a one-time winner of Future Stars of Wrestling, and a two-time winner of the NWA UCW Zero Ultra X Championship. And in 2021, she made her WWE debut on NXT. So she's having a terrific time. In fact, they're in New York City right now. He's, I think, in a hotel room watching the cats while she's at a show. So anyway, enough ramblings from me. We haven't seen Tom. You and I haven't seen Tom for probably about 5 years, I would say.
Yeah, it's been a minute
or so, and I'm excited to talk to him. So we'll just get out of here. Let's get right in, or not get out of here. Let's get in with Tom.
Hey, what's up, podcast world? This is AWOL One, and one of my favorite shows is DOD45 with ArtByTai, and today. You got Tom Howard. Don't be a coward. Listen to Tom Howard. He'll wrap his knuckles around your skull and just squeeze and squeeze all the slime out of your ears. Tom Howard, badass Tom Howard. Yeah, check it out.
Ladies and gentlemen, can I please have your attention? Stop what you're doing and listen.
DOD45.
This is the DOD45 show, drawing over discussions 45 minutes with a special guest. Welcome. I'm your host and resident artist, Ty of ArtByTai, and with my co-host, Adrian Taiwali'i, we're having conversations with people who I admire and am inspired by. On this episode, I'll set a 45-minute timer, put my pen to the paper, and we'll learn about our guest through an interview-style discussion. So stay right here with us to experience some laughs and maybe even learn a thing or two.
DOD45.
Hey, so exciting. Welcome to the show. Thanks for joining us, Tom.
Thank you, sir.
How have you been?
I've been good, man. Traveling. I'm in, I took a red eye to New York. I thought I was going to be in New York, and then we caught a flight to Ohio, and now I'm in Ohio. So we have a show here tonight. I travel with my wife. She's wrestles in the WWE Monday Night Raw. Her name is Zoey Stark. So I travel with her. And it's a lot of fun.
I do want to ask, is it weird now being not the performer, like you're like the backstage person? I mean, I know that's been the case for a while now, but.
Yeah, it takes all the pressure off. It does two things. Number one, I think I wasn't horribly present when I was a performer. I found, especially in Japan, I spent almost 15 years going back and forth to Japan. And every time I was in Japan, all I wanted to do was be home. And every time I was home, all I wanted to do was be back in Japan. So now that I'm not under the pressure, I'm able to see it for what it is. And I can really help her to absorb it and be present the entire time.
Yeah. So. Is there somebody in the like say if you're wrestling for WWE or whatever, is there someone in that in the company or something that helps athletes deal with or like to do that stuff now? Or was there ever someone like that?
There definitely was not when I was there.
Right.
It was the Wild West.
Yeah.
Wild West, a lot of drugs, a lot of partying, a lot of alcohol. It's entirely changed. It's gotten very healthy now. And you've got a lot of great support system in place. So, you know, they have the wrestlers that are agents that help out with the matches, they give advice. It's just a really, it's really a positive environment now. So yeah, it's entirely changed.
That's good, because that's how you extend the careers of an athlete. That if an athlete's making you big money, like that's how you extend their career. You know, keeping them healthy mentally and physically.
Yeah, it's like we were talking about, I was talking with my wife about it. It's like by the time someone becomes a Navy SEAL, the military has invested millions and millions of dollars in them. By the time you're in the main event in WWE, they've got millions of dollars invested in you and they want to see you succeed. So, you know, it's a good thing.
Yeah, that's cool.
Tony, I have to apologize. I don't think I knew that you guys got married. So I'm sorry. Congratulations.
Oh, well, thank you very much. We have not involved the government in our marriage yet, but we are married.
Okay, got it.
Yeah, we've been together for 12 years now. We may involve the government one of these days, but we're not that big of fans.
All right. Well, we were just saying it's probably been like 5 years since we've seen you, so this is awesome. Yeah.
I know. Come to think of it, it was when I first moved to Utah, and that would have been... Let's see. You met Teresa before, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Right when you guys were first. Oh, yeah. So it's probably even been longer.
It would have been longer. You're talking like 10, 11 years.
Yeah. Isn't that crazy how quick time goes?
Have we not seen you at all since then?
Crazy.
But time passes. Time's crazy. But we're here now. And that's all that matters.
Oh, yeah.
All right. So I'm going to. So again, welcome to our show called the DOD45 Show. And thank you for joining us. And Adrian did bring up the point when I was saying, well, our guest today is in our intro, I was saying our guest today is Tom Howard, who is my cousin. But we're having you on for both reasons because of what you've accomplished in your lifetime. And you also are a family member. And since it's a Thanksgiving episode, who better to spend time with than with your family? So.
Perfect.
All right. So for the next 45 minutes, I'm going to draw this picture for you. And we'll have a little discussion, okay?
Oh, that's awesome, man.
Before I do it, this whole show started as a way to celebrate people who've accomplished things to aspire to. Is there someone, a specific person or situation that inspired you to end up doing what you do now?
You know what? I don't know if I can say a specific person, but I can say that... I got married at a young age, had kids at a young age, got a suit and tie job, and realized that I was not going to be a good fit for that. And so I started driving hours to go to a pro wrestling school of all things. And took train for 2 years to do it. So I don't know that there was one person per se, as much as it was just me being motivated to find something bigger and better to do with my life than be normal, just the 9-to-5er.
Yeah. So it was more of a situational thing that got you into what you're doing.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
And then you actually have a brother named Jerry. And did people ever crack jokes about that when you were growing up? Cause I don't know why, but like I never registered that it was Tom and Jerry when I was growing up. I just never did.
I never thought about that either.
I think because Jerry was older, it was Jerry and Tom. It wasn't as common, but yeah, I heard it here and there, but it wasn't a big thing.
Right. You know, that's right. Cause it would usually in reference to you guys, it would have been Jerry and Tom. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't ring like Tom and Jerry. Yeah. All right. I'm going to start this timer and then I'll start drawing for you. Also just for your heads up, since this is a Thanksgiving episode, I'm going to draw one of those hand turkeys.
Sweet.
You know, the ones that, used to draw back in school. Let me just shape out my hand. But while I do that, here's your first Sophie's Choice question, okay? There are two actors who often play tough guys. But who'd win in a real MMA match, Tom Cruise or Tom Hardy?
I'm going to say Tom Hardy, unless Tom Cruise can use his Scientology magic.
Now, are you aware that... Hardy's been winning in jiu-jitsu matches. He's a blue belt.
And that's why I say that. Plus he just seems like a badass. He could draw on the energy more.
Is blue belt like is that good? I don't know anything about belts, so
Yeah. Blue's your second belt in jiu-jitsu. Jiu-jitsu's only got five belts, so it's like means you've done it for at least a couple of two or three years.
It's not based on, but it's based on your skill level, what kind of belt you get, right?
Correct.
Okay. Yeah, I don't know much about that stuff. I wish I did.
Yeah, if someone is a brown belt, they're pretty damn good. And if they're a black belt, they're pretty much expert.
Okay.
Blue belt means they could pretty much kick anyone's ass on the street unless they're trained.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, Tom Hardy's like, it's cool. I think that's pretty cool. Like, he's actually putting himself out on there.
Oh, yeah.
Did you take boxing at all, or you're trained boxing? You did box training, right? Boxing?
Yeah. I did boxing, kickboxing, and then I taught it for quite a few years. I used to own a gym down in San Clemente that was a kickboxing gym as well.
Did you get into it all because of our grandpa who gave a licking to the champion, one-time champion, Gene Fulmer?
It's funny because I remember hearing that story a million times. As our grandfather, Bob Howard, the great Bob Howard, as he started getting Alzheimer's, he would tell that story over and over and over. So we both heard it. I'm sure you heard it 100 times. And his joke was that he was a human punching bag and he really knew how to take a punch. And I turned into the same thing in my fight career. So, but I always found it honorable just to be able to step out there and do it, you know?
Yeah.
And like how many people actually get to do it. And that's the big thing.
Well, did you wrestle like in high school or anything? Cause it seemed like your whole family was wrestlers.
Yeah. Right. We all wrestled. We did freestyle, Greco-Roman, and what's called folk style, which is the, regular high school style. And then we did the tournaments, over the summer, you know, the summer league as well.
Yeah.
So I didn't do it in college. My brother Kenny did it in college. He got a scholarship to BYU.
Oh, wow.
And
he was awesome. He was a big, strong human.
Yeah. He still scares me. he's the one brother that I wouldn't really want to mess with.
weren't you in an Ong Bak movie?
Yeah. I did a movie in Thailand. What it was one of my former students, a guy named Nathan Jones, got hired to do a movie down there. And all the Thai guys were too small. And he kind of semi-demanded that he bring in some of his own guys. So we got a phone call. And within a week, we were flown down to Thailand. And I did an incredibly long fight scene where I got electrocuted. And we did so many amazing things in this fight scene. So it was a lot of fun. It was just the Ong Bak people. It was called Somtom, which is translated, the English version was called Thai Giant.
Yeah.
Like in Blockbuster, you could go get it. It's called Thai Giant.
Yeah. I remember watching it. Were you a military guy in that one or something?
Yeah. Just a standard thug.
he's legit, right?
Oh yeah. Very legit. He was from the movie Troy. If you remember in the opening scene, the giant guy, Boagrius,
who gets stabbed from Brad Pitt.
Gets stabbed. And then, of course, now in the Mad Max, the new Mad Max movies, he plays one of the main characters in that as well. He's the one who brought me down. We were only supposed to be there for 3 weeks, and we ended up, they kept us there for almost 2 months.
Wow.
Yeah. That's fun.
But it was a lot of fun, man. Good times.
I bet.
Yeah, absolutely.
You've been everywhere.
You have.
Yeah.
Like absolutely everywhere.
Yeah.
Was going through. I'm going to get to a bunch of some things on here that I are like these highlights that I definitely remember that I think people would have get a kick out of checking out. One of the other things too that I think is really cool is how did the Nacho Libre gig come about?
Okay. So years ago, I did this training video series where I was training John Cena, Samoa Joe, a bunch of the top wrestlers. We were development territory for WWE. And they the series was for sale at Walmart, and it became like the top series. Matter of fact, to this day, when I go backstage at WWE, a lot of the wrestlers will say, man, that's the first, that's how I learned to wrestle from watching your videos.
Oh, cool.
So yeah, it turns out that the guy that the stunt coordinator had heard that I was someone who was a wrestling instructor who had actually wrestled in Mexico. When I first started wrestling, I trained under a Lucha Libre stylist, and they were setting the Mexican company came to America to do a show in Los Angeles at the LA Sports Arena. So I went with them to help set up the ring. And as soon as the owner of the company showed up, you know, my trainer said something in Spanish, and he tells me, jump in the ring and show him some stuff. So I jumped in the ring and did some twisty, flippy wrestling stuff, and didn't hear anything back. I gave him a little promo kit, and then I got a phone call maybe a month later, and they say, this guy says, hey, we'd like you to come down this weekend. We have a big pay-per-view, and we want you to do your Russian character called KGB. We have a angle called Mexico contra el mundo, meaning Mexico versus the world. And so they had this Samoan guy who was playing a sumo wrestler. They had me playing a KGB Russian, and they had a Mexican guy under a mask playing an American. And we fought all of the top Mexicans. And it's hugely popular in Mexico.
Yeah.
So anyway, that's the backstory to that.
What's the significant difference between that Lucha Libre wrestling and American wrestling?
Okay, so they have, they have 2 out of 3 falls, which is very interesting.
When you say the falls, is that how many times?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So 2 out of 3 falls, meaning like that you don't just, the match isn't over with just one pin.
Right.
So it's 2 out of 3.
Oh, okay.
And so a lot of times they'll have, you know, and so they have the good guys, and they're called technicos, and the bad guys are called rudos. And so the technicos might win the first match. The rudos might win the second match. And then the third match will be the big, you know, the big, face off. And they don't have the same rules we do, in that you don't have to tag. And there's sometimes 4 or 5 people on each side of the ring. And my first match there, I didn't know that much about the specifics of it. When I got there, I had trained the moves, but I had never done these matches. So the first match I was there, I was on TV in front of a massive audience, and the match went like 50 minutes, and I was blown up tired after about 10, 15 minutes.
Wow.
So just sucking wind the whole time, you know, and I could tell all the Mexican guys I was fighting were running from me, because I just started stiffing them left and right. And they didn't want to fight, you know, they're trying to be professional. They don't want to fight. So they just like run from you the whole time. So it was pretty funny.
Or do they, and does it, I guess, cause I haven't watched much of it. But they don't, so a lot of, it seems like a lot of American wrestling is like size and big muscly thing. Uh-huh. Is that, but is that the case in Mexico?
Or it seems
like
no.
Kind of it's smaller, it's much acrobatic sort of.
Acrobatic. Yeah. They call it spots. And, a spot is basically, a little acrobatic routine, like a little Cirque du Soleil routine that you do back and forth. So whereas America, we will call a wrestling match based on basic psychology, and then we'll do a lot of talking in the ring. They don't do that at all in Mexico. It's everything's pretty much planned out.
Do they have storylines?
They do have storylines. Yeah, but they're very convoluted. And if you ask almost anyone what the rules are, I've still never gotten a straight answer. No one knows.
So you're kind of like, the butcher's wife with the 3 blind mice. Like,
pretty much.
They're just kind of running circles around you, and you're trying to get
I was there for 2 years, and I still never learned the rules. But I will tell you this, the people in Mexico believe that it's real. And I went from,
oh, that could be bad.
Yeah. Well, I was a bad guy.
Yeah.
And I went from, the first time getting there, you know, tall blonde, I'm 6'3", 4", 250. So I stand out pretty dramatically. Mm-hmm. I went from being completely able to walk down the street to within the first day that I was on TV, people were walking by, pulling over, screaming, yelling, you know, they believe it's real. So it was very, very interesting. And then they had me attack this guy. They had me do two very interesting things right away. One of them was they had me attack this Mexican legend, and I had this hammer and sickle belt, and I wrapped it around his neck, and then I threw him over the top rope and I hung him. And he had cut himself so many times that his head would bleed if he just touched it. So here he is dripping blood, and I'm hanging him with this thing. Oh, so the fans really, really hated me. And then the second thing was I always had this they had these two Mexican models that would carry the hammer and sickle flags out with me. They bleached their hair blonde, and people kept grabbing the flags when we would walk by. And so I asked the guy backstage, I said, "What do I do?" And he says, "You got to make them afraid of you." So I said, "Well, what do you want me to do?" And he says, "Grab the first guy who grabs the flag, pull him over the rail and beat the shit out of him."
Oh.
And I said, "What?" I go, "They're going to throw me in jail." He goes, "No, we'll pay off the police. We'll make sure it's good."
Oh my God.
So yeah. So sure enough, this guy grabs the flag. I grab him. I'm like, "Sorry," throw him over the rail and start laying elbows into him. And of course they end up pulling me off, and then they pay off the police and everything's good. But after that, no one grabbed the flags.
Yeah, of course. They were right. They know what they're doing. were you laying off a little bit, or were you giving full elbows to the guy?
No. I don't like to hurt people.
No, of course not.
yeah. Even when I did the fighting stuff, I had done pro wrestling for so long. And then I got recruited to do the fighting stuff in Japan. I found myself stopping the punches right on the skin because my body was so used to doing it in front of huge audiences that here I am, my first match in an MMA fight. And it's really hard for me to A, hurt someone that I don't hate.
Yeah.
And B, follow through with anything, you know, in that scenario, because my body's so used to performing in this condition. And
yeah.
You know, naturally taking care of the person.
That makes a lot of sense. But you think that that's what happens to a lot of wrestlers, like someone like Brock Lesnar or other wrestlers that go into the MMA fighting thing that just doesn't. Well, I mean, that's the only one example I know. But
no. Brock Lesnar is actually kind of a mean guy. So I don't think it affects him in the same fashion. And he also was NCAA Division I wrestling champion. So he's a different level. You know, yeah. I'm a martial artist who could hang, but nowhere near, and these guys fought their way to get up there from their country or the best in their country. So it's like, okay, you know, good luck.
Yeah. A different route to the ring than what you took.
Exactly.
Okay. So here's another one. This would be very, a very unorthodox way either way. But whose music would you rather have for your ring entrance hype music before a fight? Tom Waits or Tom Petty?
I don't even know who Tom Waits is. Well, oh shoot. Man, I'm going to have to pass on that one. We'll say Tom Petty.
Yeah. But if you did go Tom Petty, do you know much Tom Petty's music? I don't really, I mean, you know the music, but I don't know any titles of them, but
I don't know. No,
it's not what it's not your typical hype music that you would come out to.
You're just thinking of Toms, huh?
I am. I'm just using Toms.
Okay, gotcha.
Hey, sometimes when you close your eyes, do you re-experience punches from Butterbean?
Butterbean is one of my best friends.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I had met him and his wife when I was in England fighting, and he had asked me, we were doing a talk show, and he had asked me, he said, "I got a show coming up in my hometown, and I was wondering if you'd like to come and fight me." And I said, "Absolutely," you know, but he had a bottle of absinthe that he had just bought, the good stuff that you can't get in the States. And I said, "Yeah, if you bring that, if you share that bottle of absinthe with me, I will do it." Well, I'm just thinking I'm never going to hear anything. Within a month of getting home, I get a call from my agent. He says, Butterbean's called. He wants you to come out. Here's the money he's going to pay you. They fly me out. I do a fight with him. We do a after show, after party, and he pulls the absinthe bottle out. And we partake. I threw a flying knee in the beginning of that match to his head. I ran and did a flying knee, and I actually kind of semi-landed it. And he's so big that I just flipped over and landed on like on my back, and he didn't move.
Do you happen to know what he weighed in at that when you fought him?
Yeah, back then he was in the 400s. Yeah, 400s. He's done DDP yoga now, if you know what that is. Diamond Dallas Page yoga.
Yeah, and I've seen pictures of him. He's lost a lot of weight.
Yeah, he has, man. I was just with him in LA, and he looks like a whole different person. And he acts like a different person. He's like a kid. I went and visited him. One time I was driving with my wife through across the country for some business, and I look over and I see Jasper, Alabama, and I'm like, Jasper, Alabama, that's where Butterbean lives. So I know he has a place called Mr. Bean's Barbecue. So I got off and went there, and sure enough, I got to go sit down and have a meal with him and, you know, surprise him and everything. But he was in such bad shape. They told him he couldn't get his hips and knees done until he lost weight. And of course you can't lose weight until you can move. So he showed up and he's hunched over with a cane. And I mean, it was hard to look at, you know. Yeah. It's one of those things where you kind of go, oh geez. I never thought he'd pull his way through, and then seeing him like he is now, it's just, wow.
That's amazing. When I was Googling to rewatch the fight, and then when I Googled his name, he came up, and he does look like a different human being, real different. Like,
what is it? Yeah. What did you say he does? DDP yoga?
Diamond Dallas Page.
Yeah, this guy named Diamond Dallas Page. He was a pro wrestler who started pro wrestling at an older age, and he developed his own yoga program. And most of the wrestlers, not most, but quite a few of the wrestlers have adopted it. And he brings people to his little compound. Mm-hmm. He made a bunch of money off this program because he had it on Shark Tank. So he had it on Shark Tank, and they made him a bunch of offers, and he turned it all down. But it was a great advertisement for him. So he sold millions and millions of prescriptions or subscriptions. Right. So he was able to use the money to build this kind of compound. And now he brings people out there and helps them out.
Wow, that's awesome.
Yeah, he's like an advocate for a lot of the older wrestlers too, right? Does he do like some mental health stuff too in that yoga kind of? Or
absolutely. Yeah. Well, you know, you have Jake the Snake, of course. And
that's right. That's what I saw that on. Wasn't he in the documentary?
He was the guy that pretty much he's helped out a lot of people.
Yeah, that's good. It's awesome to have people like that care about people that they came up with, and even people who are in the same profession. I love that.
Oh, yeah. Well,
and it's hard. It's not like there's so many of you who have these same experiences. So it seems like you probably have to stick together, because the common person doesn't probably understand the half of what you guys do or go through.
Yeah, there's not too many people who make it out alive back into civilian world. You know, you got a lot of people that just don't make it out, and then very few make it out as productive members of society.
Yeah, well, and since we're here on this topic, I was going to save asking about it later on. But that happened with my other cousin, James, the Samoan Prince Volcano Kid, rest in peace. But yeah, he took his life. But yeah, he was suffering from things that came from his wrestling career. I think when I tell people that I've got a family member from the professional wrestling world, I tend to think they think I'm speaking about someone from my Samoan family.
Yeah.
But I'm fortunate that I have one from my Samoan family and from my other family. So, but I was wondering, did you ever meet?
Yeah, I knew James very well. I was at his funeral, actually. It was sad. And I knew him well. And what happens, unfortunately, I've had several friends do this. They pull away before this happens, and then you kind of take it personally. This wasn't the case with James, because I wasn't as close with him near the end, but inevitably they pull away And then all of a sudden it happens.
Yeah.
And so it's like, you know, it's like there's an isolation that occurs. And so, you know, you always think, oh man, what should have been there for him. But yeah, when I first met him, he came out, did the fire dance. We wrestled together in Vegas. He was awesome.
Yeah.
What a specimen. I mean, he absolutely had all the tools to make it big in the business.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess that is that's one of the downsides. But I guess that's what we were talking about in the first part of this discussion, is now that they're aware of these things, they have a little more tools to give to wrestlers and, you know, to help keep them from situational things like that, I guess.
Well, that's also that compound thing that you were talking about. That could be very special for that reason.
Diamond Dallas
alone. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not to mention, there's another very real thing, and that's CTE. I know James had, he played football as well, right?
Yeah.
And so, you know, there's always that question in the back of my head, because I've had a lot of friends who I did fighting with and wrestling with, and you could tell things were progressively getting worse. And
oh, like I'm the not, concussion thing?
Yeah, that's CTE.
CTE. WWE is very careful about it now.
Yeah.
But back in the day, you know, like I said, it was Wild West. I remember getting concussed badly in a match and going and like hiding under the bleachers so that no one would be able to, like, you know, the doctors wouldn't be able to find me. And because if they found you and figured you were concussed, then you couldn't travel for X period of time, you know, or it would be on your records.
Right.
And then, so anyway, yeah, I'm not certain in his situation, but I have to question if that's not possibly part of it as well.
Yeah. I think that probably is. Who knows though? Were you afraid at all when you were first standing in the middle of the ring with Hong Man Choi?
No. Why? Actually, you know, it's a weird thing. I never experienced fear. So in Japan, they had me as right before I left for Japan, they called me the day before and they say, we've informed the press that you're a former Green Beret, like a killing machine, and that your moves are going to be called special techniques and you're going to do a different one each time. And so, like, a lot of the guys that I fought and wrestled actually believed, you know, they made a big point of it. So they believed I was a Green Beret. So when I first met Hong Man Choi, first of all, he looks very, very odd. His head is twice the size of a normal head. It looks like he's wearing a mask.
Yeah.
But when I first met him and looked him in the eyes, he was scared shitless.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And there's something that occurs. Yeah, I've been in, you know, I worked as bouncer for years, and I've been in enough situations with men to where you can kind of like, you kind of have to establish who's who and what's what. I mean, regardless of what happens after that, but you still have to own it initially.
Yeah.
So I learned how to own it pretty early. So I never experienced fear that way. I probably should have. Would have been a lot smarter for me too, but I never experienced fear that way.
Well, sometimes your own psyche, like for someone, like if he'd already initially was afraid, that's like you're already one up on him there, regardless of the size of anything. But yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And was that exaggerated? Because I mean, it says he was 7'2", 400 pounds, but I mean, he's towering over you.
Yeah. No, that's legit. That's legit. He had to have his pituitary removed because he was scheduled to die. Most of those guys don't live past their late 30s. So he had to have his pituitary removed, and that made him very weak near the end. But when I fought him, he was so incredibly strong that I remember hitting him a couple of times, and it's real awkward trying to hit him in the head, and then because it's so high, and then I just feel these hands in the back of my head, and I try to pull back, and I mean, I'm going nowhere quick, and then the knee comes up. And then I fly back in the back, you know, and then my head got busted open real bad. That was like maybe a 10 or 12 stitcher.
Yeah. Do you remember that knee at all? Like when it happened, or was it all blur?
Vaguely. Yeah. No, I do remember it. It's weird because I've never been knocked out. I've had flash knockouts. And so And then you see footage, and then I can't for sure tell you what was from the footage or what was from my memory, because it's all becomes a bit of a blur.
Yeah.
So I never got to the point, and I was also drinking back then.
Oh,
it's like, it all became a bit mushy.
Yeah. Yeah. But yeah, now you can go watch that on YouTube and see Tom take a nice big knee from the Korean Colossus.
I'm just very lucky that, like, if you think about it, could have like hit my nose and, you know, busted my nose up real bad. Fortunately, once your nose breaks enough times, it becomes pretty soft. This cartilage becomes soft. But there's a bunch of guys who get the sideways breaks, and they end up with this really badly crooked nose. So mine won't really break anymore. It's like got that soft cartilage going now.
Yeah. Well,
that's one of the benefits.
Do you happen to remember what your height and weight, what the height and weight difference was between you and the Korean Colossus? It was pretty significant, right?
Yeah. I'm 6'3", 6'4"-ish, and I always am right around 250 to 260.
Yeah, so he was almost twice the human.
Yeah.
So they don't.
That was heavy, super heavyweights, or were there not weight classes back then?
No. So what it was, K1. Okay, so K1 is the biggest company in Japan, bigger than Pride back in the day, and Pride was the predecessor to UFC, and they're owned by the. You know, this is all run by the mob. So they're owned by the Yamaguchi family. And so big
that's
money.
That's like Yakuza kind of thing, sort of thing,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. 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 There's different families that that run this stuff. So they decided to do, they brought in a guy named Akebono, who was a famous sumo wrestler. They brought in me, a Green Beret. They brought in a bunch of people. They wanted to do kind of like, freak matches or side matches. I don't know what you call them, side attractions. Knowing full well, they weren't going to be, competitive matches per se, but it was about drawing people. We're talking about arenas. I think the first one there was, close to 80,000 people.
Wow.
In the Saitama Super Arena, one of those arenas. So it was New Year's Eve, but they decided that they wanted to get into the MMA game. So I think my first match I did was MMA there. And then I think with him, it was kickboxing. Yeah, because he didn't want to do MMA back then. But I just did whatever they wanted me to do. They offered me a good contract, good money, and for 2 years, like 8 fights, and it was enough to, you know.
And they treated you like royalty while you were over there, right?
Yeah, very, very well.
Yeah.
And I got to open a gym, got a beach house, and, you know, it did pretty well for a while with it. Yeah. So it was nice. It was kind of like you're going to take some lumps, but you can get out of this crazy travel schedule for a bit.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not talking like lifelong retirement. Maybe if I was smart with the money, it could have been, but, you know, enough to just relax for a few years.
Yeah. Did they typically, were they storylines like American wrestling, like for those MMA fights, were they giving people storylines? Like if you were the Green Beret, or was that just something that they used to hype, or was it typical to have a storyline?
Nah, they didn't really do storylines. I'm trying to think. I don't think I ever was part of a storyline in that.
Well, I watched a fight with you. We were talking about, your name came up in another episode a couple weeks ago.
Your name comes up in almost every episode.
I know, because we talk about wrestling a lot. But you were fighting. I think it was in Japan, and you were the Green Beret. But it looked like it was almost a wrestling match, because there seemed like there were some fake slaps happening to you against the ropes. It was this. I think it was a Japanese guy, but like you punched him back. Like you were punching him.
Was he a big fat guy? Looked like Elvis.
No. Well, maybe. Yeah. An Asian Japanese guy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Was that a real fight, or was it like a half fight, half?
No, You can tell because the real fights in K1 always ended with me getting stitched up.
Yeah. Well, in this particular fight, he was like, he looked like he was pulling his punch, like he was kind of slapping, but you hit him back on the face. Like it looked incredibly legit punch. Now, maybe you were holding it a little bit, but he went down.
And
I was just wondering if that happens in when you're doing these quote unquote pretend matches. If anyone every once in a while kind of you get hit and then you get angry and so you kind of feed them back. Is that a typical thing that happens?
Yeah, I had one guy that they brought over from Korea and he was a Hapkido master and he acted like he didn't speak English. And as soon as we got out there and we talked the match over with the translator and I was supposed to win, but you know, we're talking about stiff stuff. Like in America, they do a lot of hold punches that are real obvious, running the ropes. This is more like a fight and, you know, everything has to hit or the fans don't buy it at all. So, you know, you just don't aim for the nose or the eyes. And you try not to knock the guy out, and hopefully he doesn't knock you out. And you know, you grit your teeth and bear it. But this guy, right in the beginning of the match, teed off on my nuts, and it was so bad that I went dropped my knee, and I tried to stand back up. And I had never had this happen before, and I literally couldn't stand back up.
Oh shit!
And so here I am, and it's a big pay per view,
and I'm supposed to win the match.
Yeah, I'm supposed to win. And I'm not even able to stand up. And I grab the ropes and I start to pull myself up. And he comes over, he starts kicking and kicking, kicking.
Oh, shit.
And I'm like, oh, you son of a bitch. I don't think it was on purpose, but all I could do, I finally just caught one of his kicks, grabbed him around the neck, and then threw him on his head. And then he jumped up and starts kicking me again. And that's all I could do. Every time he started kicking me, I just ate the kick, caught him, and threw him on his head. And did it over and over throughout the match. And that was an actual shoot. And then I finally ended up throwing him on his head and then putting him in a reverse triangle choke. And then we got in a fight in the back.
Oh, shit.
I'm not proud of it. I'm not proud of it.
Right. Sure.
It got pulled apart, you know, but that's the only time I really had a, you know, here's what happens when you, same thing happened in Mexico and same thing happened in Japan. When you get there, the wrestlers will all start to practice before and they figure out right away who's who and what's what.
Right.
And so because I grew up doing amateur wrestling and then I did some Sambo. So I learned how to do leg locks. I learned a lot of like sneaky tricks that once again, not enough to do to like win a bunch of high level world class pro fights, but enough to, you know, be able to beat all the amateur, the pro wrestler guys. So I made pretty quick work of the guys. And then after that, they're all afraid of you.
Right.
And so from that point forward, there you got the respect factor. And if you don't have that, they will eat your lunch.
Well, yeah, that's what I was wondering. Do you can you tell if someone accidentally caught you or if someone's like definitely trying to like one up you?
Yeah, yeah. We apologize to each other in the ring. And we also say there's a word we say receipt. And the receipt means you got one coming. So, if you got, you know, you will just say the word receipt and that means you expect it.
Do you get receipts even if it was an accidental, like if someone accidentally caught you, you go, oh, you're getting a receipt for that one.
If the guy doesn't apologize.
Yeah,
for sure.
Awesome.
And if if there's gross negligence involved, he's going to get one way or the other.
Yeah. 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 That's how you protect yourself in the ring probably. Right. Yeah.
Is it hard to watch Teresa get hit and stuff?
No, Teresa's a badass. First of all, Teresa's was competitive in jujitsu while we were doing wrestling. I started training her about 12 years ago, and she's about as tough and as bad as they come. And so, there's I feel bad for the other girls.
Okay.
I'm never worried about Teresa.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Yeah.
And you guys were she was just in Saudi.
Yeah. She was in Saudi for the second time. Saudi does a bot show. I think they pay like $50 million to do what, 3 or 4 times a year to have the wrestlers come over and do a show.
Yeah.
And she just won the big battle royal. So she has to go against the main girl for her belts, Rhea Ripley. That's coming up on the next big pay-per-view or whatever you want to call them these days.
That's so fun.
Yeah.
Fun and hard work, though. Like, not, it's not like you're just, it's all party.
Yeah. I mean, what happens in a ring is the party. What happens, like last night, for example, we get you get to the airport around, you leave around 10 in an Uber, you get to the airport around 11, you catch your red eye around 12:45. For whatever reason, they flew us to New York. And then we had to go from New York, which I wasn't sure because I think I told you I was going to be in New York because I didn't know. I didn't talk to her. She wasn't back. And then they flew us to Ohio, which is going backwards from Vegas to New York to here. And then we got here, and now she's actually laying in bed for an hour or two until she has to go to the show to go do a match here tonight.
Oh, man.
So that's the reality. And then tomorrow morning, we jump in the car, drive 4 hours, and do it again.
Where?
And then the next day.
Oh, wow.
Tomorrow.
So that's a tight schedule.
Yeah.
Is there a season or is it all year?
All year. Yeah. Every Monday is the TV show called Raw. And so inevitably you have to be here for that. And then these are called house shows. And these are the shows that will be slightly smaller. Like, I think the show that we did in Vegas that your family all came to was that would have been TV taping. That was at the Jazz Center. But it just depends on the size of the venue, you know, but I'm not sure. This is probably like a 10,000 seat venue or something. That's what they usually do.
That's based on, and those are usually based on the market, like where, like how it go, you know, whatever exactly. City you're in, the market.
That's, yeah. Yeah. It's surprising, but the amount of sellouts or close to sellouts, it's remarkable. I don't go to all the shows. Actually, we bring our cat with us.
Okay.
And like tonight, I'm literally going to sit here and watch TV with the cat because I don't feel like going to watch the wrestling show. Because, you know, if you do it every single night, it takes a lot of energy. I don't want to go sit and watch a wrestling show tonight. And I don't want to go backstage and deal with any politics. I mean, I know everyone and they're nice and I like them, you know, but I'm tired as hell. I'm going to be a cat dad tonight.
That's what he said. In the beginning, I was like, what do you mean he's watching? Like, I thought you were watching Cats, the musical.
Oh, the musical.
Oh, no. We have a cat that travels with us. We smuggle him into the rooms. And he travels with us everywhere we go.
And no hotel no hotel allows cats to stay there.
No.
Smell does not go away.
Yeah.
All right. I got about 3 more minutes in the timer, and then we'll do the first worsts and first worsts and thirsts. No shit. First worst and favorite segment. Before I get to that, I'll do a couple of the Sophie's Choice, just because I like to get them in because they're kind of a staple of the show. But who was better, Tommy Lee Jones in the miniseries Lonesome Dove or Tom Selleck in Magnum P.I.?
Oh, gee. Where do you get these from? Magnum P.I., I guess. I like Tommy Lee Jones better as an actor. I don't recall either one, though, to be honest with you.
You don't like Tom Selleck's mustache?
I like Tom Selleck's mustache, but you're talking to a guy who got hit in the head for a living, man. You're asking me a bunch of questions about old things that I have very little recollection of.
And they always, and most people don't, they're always just, the Sophie's Choices are always just based on your name.
Well, no, I put it together after the fourth Tom and the fact that they were utterly random. And I'm just like, where's he going with this? I thought maybe you had somewhere you're going, but utterly, there's no basis.
Just for a laugh.
There's probably some Howies or how.
Yeah, I got one here. Here's a couple. Who would win in a no holds barred cage match between Tom Hanks and Tom Green?
Tom Green? I mean, is that really a question?
Yeah. Because who would you say? You would say Tom Hanks?
Well, yeah. Yeah, I'd have to say Tom Hanks. Tom Green, yeah.
I think Tom Green, because he's now a rancher out in some farm. He's like a horse rancher. You got to be tough to do that.
Isn't he like a creeper, though? I thought that he was like a guy who went crazy and did a bunch of weird stuff.
No, I think that was mostly, typical when you don't do what Hollywood wants you to do. They start saying, oh, he's crazy. Because he's actually a pretty normal dude.
Oh, okay.
He did do a lot of crazy shit. Then who would you rather have over for Thanksgiving dinner, Ron Howard or Terrence Howard?
Man, Ron Howard, just because he's a – well, God – I love Terrence Howard too. Both.
Do I have to choose one?
Yeah.
No, you can definitely go too. And then who would throw a turkey further? Legendary Mets pitcher Tom Terrific Seaver or has been overrated Patriots quarterback Tom Brady?
I have no idea who Tom Seaver is, so I'm going to go Tom Brady.
I just wanted to get a jab in on Tom Brady because the Patriots used to be a team I did not love.
I'm glad you can amuse yourself with all this.
Yeah. I'm trying to picture if the turkey's alive or like frozen.
I think it's frozen. But yeah, Tom Seaver was a great pitcher. He's like one of the top 100 pitchers of all time.
We gotta believe throwing a football would be closer to a turkey than a baseball.
Yeah, it's a little heavier. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they trained
it. Well, just size wise, mm-hmm. You know, maybe.
Are you a fan of John Cena's raps?
Are we gonna drop this on him right here? Y'all ain't ready for this. Y'all ain't ready for none of this. Your boy's a bad man. Then we invading the streets. Make them clap a rapper skirt. They be dropping the heat. Shock the world. Now I'm standing alone. I flip fools like them clamshell cellular phones. You can't help but nod your head to the track. The water down rap. We be taking it back. Give it to me straight.
John Cena's raps? Yeah, you know what? Here's the crazy part. When I first met John, he was making smoothies at Gold's Gym. Oh. And he was a fan of wrestling. And one of the other guys who was training in wrestling said, hey, we got this guy who wants to come down and train. And his name is John. And he showed us a picture of him. And we said, yeah, bring him down. And he was real robotic. He didn't move real well. He was training in bodybuilding. He was getting ready for a show. And he was very like, yes, sir, no, sir, and did exactly what I told him to do perfectly. And I didn't get much personality out of him. And then once we had him do a promo, it was amazing. He was phenomenal. And then, of course, from that day forward, I saw him grow. And then I saw him do the rapping stuff. And I was just like, wow, because, you know, that whole rapping thing all came about because he looked a little bit like Marky Mark. How silly is that? He happens to be very skilled at, whatever. He's got an amazing ability. I'm not saying he's a great rapper, but I mean, he's got an amazing ability.
But people do actually have respect about him. Like when someone with a career like that, a wrestler is a rapper, you tend to want to make jokes about it, but he's actually good. And like, people actually respect his abilities.
Freestyle. Yeah, for sure.
Any run-ins with The Rock?
Strangely enough, The Rock's daughter was just with us in Florida, and she cats it for us and we cats it for her. So when we're on the road, so she's wrestling now at NXT. And she's just starting on television there. So, cool. But The Rock now is kind of off on his own thing, yeah. You know, but I knew him back when he was on, before he was the big famous Rock, you know, just the guy who was just on WWE.
It was funny that you mentioned that Cena didn't really have a personality when he first trained him. Cause now he's like all personality.
Yeah.
Like, he's a real funny guy. This is the question I ask everybody before I go into the first worst. I say, what advice would 2023 Tom have for 1990 Tom?
Number one, be present. As I mentioned before, I found that I was always going to be happy when, and whenever I was on the road, all I wanted to do was be home. Whenever I was home, all I wanted to do was be on the road. And I didn't really understand, you know, Eckhart Tolle, The Power of Now. When I didn't quite understand it, I'd read the books and stuff, but when you can truly understand being present, that changes everything. So
Do you think that 1990 Tom would have listened to 2023 Tom?
No. The problem was that's the biggest problem is that it takes time. I used to be a part of that whole thing back in those days was running hard and chasing hard. And I used to be a big drinker. And so it was all about just going and going and going. So like finally now that I'm not doing, you know, that I'm living a very clean life, it changes dramatically your point of view.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's just, no, I don't think so.
Yeah. Plus when you're in the younger ages, you think, you know, everything, you don't need to hear it even from your own self. All right, here we go. Yeah. We're going to get into the dish. This is the rapid fire first worsts and favorites. What was your first professional wrestling match?
I wrestled in Las Vegas in the Silver Nugget as KGB, the Russian assassin, versus a guy named Gary Key, who was dressed as a ninja. And it was for a television show that was in Las Vegas. And I won.
Was he full ninja costume too?
Full ninja. And he was a white guy who had a bad country accent. And he was doing all the ninja stuff with his hands. And it looked horrible.
Who was your first celebrity crush?
I'm going to go Heather Locklear, just because I'm old. And she was like the hot girl on TV back in the day.
What was your first car?
69 Volkswagen van, pop top, camper. Got it from my neighbor for $750. And we would drive to the beach. We tore out the base and put carpet in it and made it all nice. And then my friend from Spain, who was a foreign exchange student, told me that he had driven before, and I let him drive it, and he rolled it.
Oh my God.
And we were near the school, and he was going to have to be sent back to Spain because he wasn't supposed to be driving, didn't have a license. So I sent them. We all picked it up, me and my four friends, and went back on its feet, and I sent them running. And then I took the heat for it.
Oh, yeah, look at you. Yeah, that's a good friend to have around, man. Good on you.
what a bummer.
Yeah, though. That is a bummer. Was it like one of the Westphalia ones, or was it like a bus?
No, 69. Yeah, the pop, the top would pop up, and you could sleep up top.
Bummer, I didn't know those rolled that easy.
Oh, dude, those things roll in a heartbeat. Oh, here's the funny part. About 3 years later, my brother Brian... We got it fixed up, but well enough to drive. My brother Brian rolled it in a neighborhood, and they called my parents. And my parents come up, and this guy comes out of his house, and he says to my dad, he goes, "I got to tell you something. Your son wasn't driving it. It was his friend." And sure enough, he had a 15-year-old friend who was driving it, and my brother Brian took my lead and tried to cover for his buddy.
That's awesome.
Yeah, so my parents junked that thing after that.
What was your first MMA match?
My first MMA match was, this was a big one actually. K1 had just decided they were going to do the freak show matches, and they did this big show on New Year's Eve called Dynamite. And it was in the Saitama Super Arena, I believe. It's like, I want to say 70, 80,000 people. And it was rough. I didn't get any stitches. But
did you win lose that one?
No. I lost it. I went against world class guy, obviously, as well. I was able to take him down, and he caught me in a guillotine. I fought my way out, got him in full mount, and I could tell that this was the first time they'd done MMA, and they wanted to see action, and it was already like slow, and we were like the first. Mm-hmm. First main match, and so they stood us up, and then something similar, and then finally caught me again. My neck swelled up for like 3 days. I couldn't breathe. You know, when you're in a guillotine like that, guy's like choking you for his life. You know, because anyway, so that was my first one.
What was your first paying job?
First paying job? Oh, it was a place called Professional Community Management. It was a rec center. And I was like the guy that would hang out and watch people by the pool.
Yeah. Didn't you guys, when you guys moved to California at first, didn't you guys like run a popcorn machine or something like somewhere at a mall?
Yeah. So my uncle Richie on the other side, they had all of the carts up in Beverly Hills at Century Center. And so they had a connection with the company who managed all of these malls. And so they would gave us a couple of their old carts, and then my family would do the popcorn carts there. But that was a family business. My family would give me some money here and there, and I might have actually had some sticky fingers every once in a while.
But that was a problem. That was a good business, right? I just remember
It was decent business. I mean, it was much, much better than you would ever imagine.
When was the first time you got scared from a movie?
I haven't been scared through a lot of movies. Pet Sematary.
I remember
Pet Sematary was probably one of the ones that I actually really enjoyed. And it was when the chick walked in and her sister had spinal meningitis or something. And her sister like sat up and she's like, you know, I don't know.
Something creepy. Yeah.
Yeah, I remember something like that. But that's probably it.
When was the first time you cried in a movie?
I'm not a crier.
Not at all.
I wish I could. It's just I was asking my wife about it, and we couldn't come up with it. I don't know about that one.
Who was your first best friend?
A guy named Jeff Zabel. He lost his leg from right below the knee, so he had a fake leg, and he was a Mormon kid, but he was also a troublemaker, and we somehow became best friends, and he would he did all sorts of crazy stuff. We'd go to the beach and he would like take off his fake leg while we're in the water and hand it to me, and then he'd jump up on the beach and scream shark and just stupid stuff like that. Or we'd go in the jacuzzi in the apartment complex, and then he'd take off the leg and hand it to me, and then he'd have his little limpy thing come up, and it looked like a dog because it was all gnarly, and then he'd like make barking noises, and people would just go, "What the hell?" So we did a lot. We always just did. Or he would stab his leg. I remember we were at Denny's drunk late one night, and he started getting all angry, and he took a knife and started stabbing his leg.
Oh, my God, people just started freaking out.
Was it he was stabbing the prosthetic?
The fake leg.
The prosthetic. Yeah, just stupid kid, you know, just stupid kid stuff.
Are you still in touch with him at all, or do you?
No, unfortunately, I'm not.
That's kind of been a new question to us about your first friends, because I'm not really in touch with my very first best friend. I wonder what happens there. It's a thing, but.
I will tell you what happens. I have been in touch with him, and I have several other friends from the past I've been in touch with. We just don't. We have so little in common anymore. That I reach out. You know, I'll take him to dinner, or I'll invite him out over for something, and it just fades from there. It doesn't go anywhere.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. You start when you were younger. Your world was a little bit smaller, so your views were the same in the neighborhoods you were in. So you kind of would be friends there. But then as you get older, you do different things. So it makes plenty of sense. We'll move into the worsts. What's the worst sound?
I don't do well with babies crying. And it's not the standard baby crying, but like when babies throw fits, it makes me want to actually smack the parents. And the reason being is that if I would have done that when I was a kid, And I was talking to my wife about this. I would be scared to death to do this. And when I see a kid do this, I look at the parents and just be like, what are you bringing into this world?
Yeah.
So that noise when they do it, I was in the airport today and the kid's just screaming at his parents and the parents are acting like it doesn't exist. That's probably got to be it.
Yeah. So you're less of like an actual baby, like a baby crying, but like a younger, like toddler, I guess, maybe.
No, I'm not talking about the, I mean, I don't do well with any babies crying, but, sure. The toddler that's throwing a fit is the really, truly annoying one.
I spend a lot of time on planes,
you know, so when you're on planes as much as I am, that's when you really,
You get those noise-canceling headphones?
Yes,
trust me. Absolutely.
What's the worst word?
I really dislike the word hate. And I would have to say the word hate.
Yeah.
Because I've been working with Therese a lot on this, and we find that, like in her world, and I'll just make this quick, but in wrestling, she has got to deal with a lot of people, and there's a lot of passive aggressive people, and people kind of like talk behind people's back, and so, like I always tell her, keep your thoughts pure, and you can say that it's not your favorite, but don't say hate and don't say, you know, whatever, and because otherwise it comes out and people can feel the energy of it. So I just try to really keep my thoughts and my words in alignment with the person I want to be. So hate.
Yeah, that's a good answer. Great answer, actually.
Thanks.
Who's the worst celebrity martial arts actor, or, you know, worst celebrity martial arts person?
Well, come on now. Steven Seagal's got to be. Now, he was great back in Marked for Death? Not Marked for Death. What was the first one?
Those was when he was, like, awesome.
Yes,
like Marked for Death. He was.
And one time I was driving through Beverly Hills, up in the hills, and I look over, and there he is on the side of the road in his house with his wife, Kelly LeBrock. And you look over at us, and I was like, Steven Seagal, you know, freaked out. But, boy, he has just become a bad I don't know what would you call it?
A character of
himself?
Yeah. Yep. I heard that he used to really hurt stunt guys, like in movies, like he purposely hurt them. And, you know, because they was on the job, they couldn't, even these guys could kick his ass, but they wouldn't do anything because that was, you know, they're getting paid. They didn't want to lose their gig. But
I
heard a lot of crazy stories.
It happens in wrestling too. You know, you have the guys, they call them the job guys, and those are the guys who give their body to make a star look good, and the guys who will beat them up and take advantage of them, it's unacceptable, you know.
Oh yeah, I never even thought of that. I guess that probably happens in wrestling. Yeah. What's the worst pet?
Well, they're beautiful. I mean, they're great to look at, but we had a hamster. It was a little Asian hamster, and we thought it would be cool to have Sly, our cat, have something to play with, but it was in a cage. But these things would sleep all day. We had two of them. And then all night they would run on this wheel nonstop. And so it was just this nonstop, just. And we were just like, you got to be kidding me. So we finally had to like move him in a soundproof room in our house. So you couldn't get him out of the cage because they would like run away. And then they would just make noise all night long. And I was like, what is the purpose behind this thing? So the funny thing is they both passed away and we're not sure. And then my wife says she read just two days ago, she read that they actually will go into, what do you call it when you go into sleep?
Hibernation.
So she said they hibernate for up to a month. She goes, we might have killed them. And I was like, we didn't kill them. We threw them in the trash, I believe. So if they, then they're living a perfectly good life in the dump somewhere. They're probably living a better life now.
Yeah, that's true. What's the worst MMA discipline?
I'm actually a fan of watching those videos online where the guys will do the flippy sniff stuff and the goofy not touching. I don't even know the names of them, but, you know, like the dim mock and whatever.
Yeah.
Before UFC and K1 and Pride, it was just such a bad joke because everyone was like, our martial art is so deadly that you can't use it. And so I can't give you the name, but there's so many. There's so many. most of them, quite frankly, there's a lot of hocus pocus. MMA is really, we all know where it's at.
Right. So, yeah.
Yeah.
And what's the worst wrestling nickname?
Are you talking about a wrestler I know?
Yeah, or anyone. Because sometimes the joke always comes up, the barber. That's usually people's answer to that one.
Bruce the Barber Beefcake? I know him well, actually. I worked on the Hulk Hogan Celebrity Championship Wrestling Show, and I was the coach there teaching the wrestlers. He was supposedly teaching them, but I was actually the one teaching them. Nice, real nice guy.
Sure.
There was another guy who... who's a sweetheart of a guy, and he's very, very kind to my wife, works with WWE. He did something to piss someone off, and his name is Terry Taylor, and they gave him a gimmick called the Red Rooster. And they gave him red down the middle of his hair, and they had him come out and do like cock-a-doodle-doo.
Oh, shit.
No one knew why, but it was like he pissed someone off.
Yeah.
So he would have to come in the ring every time and do cock-a-doodle-doo.
Yeah. And he would like strut around and do the rooster stuff.
Oh, no.
It's still a folklore in wrestling.
Yeah, but even though it's a horrible thing, it kind of like it sticks out. It definitely would last in someone's memory.
Yeah, I guess.
What's the worst part of professional wrestling?
Travel.
For
sure.
And we know from experience, I know a lot of people when they hear the word travel, they go like, well, what's so bad about travel? Traveling's great. But the kind of travel that you do when you're going from the same place to do the same thing, you're always in the same hotel, it's the same food, it's like really grueling. There's nothing really very exciting about it anymore.
No, especially when you have to be... Like a lot of what we do on the weekends will be fly in, catch a rental car, just like today, get to a hotel room, relax, try to get a meal in, get to the arena. She gets home or we both get home around 11, get up at 5 in the morning, get to the airport and do it again and do it again and do it again.
How do you guys find time to train?
Well, that's where you got to put in the training. I mean, like. Today we're about to go do that after this. And then she's got to head over to the arena.
Yeah,
and it's just downstairs. Like we stay at like the Embassy Suites has a great like. Hopefully we stay in hotels that are nice enough to have a decent gym, mm-hmm. or we go find a gym that's close by. You know.
Mm-hmm. What's the worst place for a wrestling match?
When I first started wrestling in Mexico, they had a lot of times they had we wrestled in. They're called El Torreo, the bullfighting arenas. So they had dirt floors and then they had boxing rings. So they had no padding, hard as rocks. And so that would have been the worst place by far.
Yeah,
and
shit.
And I just, you just try not to they're called bumps when you take a back fall and you just try not to do it. Like you only do it on the finish.
Cause there's give in rings, right? But there's no give.
Yeah. There's two types of give. There's one that has a spring underneath it. And that's a little more like a trampoline. And then the other one that WWE uses has long lumber with like a wrestling mat on top of it. But it's set up to be long enough to where it has flex and has a little bit of a bounce.
Yeah.
It makes a loud noise.
All right, we'll go into your favorites. Who's your favorite wrestler of all time?
Oh, man, that's a rough one. I'm going to say Shinya Hashimoto. He's the guy who brought me to Japan. Legendary guy. He passed away. But he's the guy who brought me to Japan, was the first guy that I had a big match with.
Who's your, what was the favorite wrestling character or gimmick that you played?
Green Beret, by far. You know, at first, as I mentioned, it wasn't something I planned. I had to literally go to an Army-Navy surplus store and go find a Green Beret and the patch and that stuff. And then, as I mentioned before, they had me do each time I was supposed to do a different finish. And then the press, here's a funny one, the press would say, what was the name of that finish? And I'd say special technique number 32. I'll just make it up. and then the next time they'd say, what was the name of that one? I'd say special technique number 16. And then all of a sudden, here I am like 6 months down the road. And I'd bring up the same numbers, totally forgetting. And then the guy would say, that looked very much like it's number 16. But you said that was number 27. And I'm like, oh man. So pretty funny.
You're getting caught up in your... Yeah, that's what happens
to liars. I couldn't keep my numbers straight, yeah.
That's what happens to liars when the lies start filing up. They can't keep up with them.
Right.
Do you have a favorite comedian?
Yeah, probably right now it's going to be Theo Von. I mean, it changes. Wow. I keep up on comedy a lot, so Theo Von.
Yeah,
probably.
He's funny, man. Yeah, yeah, that dude's really funny.
Yeah.
What's your favorite thing about wrestling?
My favorite thing about wrestling is the storytelling and the physicality. The fact that most people don't understand pro wrestling has, I'll make this quick as I can, but there's 8 segments to a pro wrestling match. Good guy, bad guy, heel, face. Number one, heel, face establishment. Number two, face outshine. It's where the good guy out wrestles the bad guy. Number three, heel cutoff. Number four, heat. Number five, near falls, or comeback. Number six, near falls. Number seven, finish. Seven, okay. I missed one of them. But anyway, so every match has these psychological elements, just like a movie. And so you're telling a story. And so my favorite part of it is to being able to tell a story through a physical play.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. What's your favorite MMA submission move?
Probably ankle lock, heel hook.
It's
something I learned pretty early on, and I was able to hook a lot of guys with it. Guys just recently got really good at it, but people didn't know how to defend it or put it on well. And I trained with a bunch of Russians in Sambo. So that would be it.
Favorite wrestling villain?
There's a couple of guys who did it really well. There's a guy named Bully Ray, who I've known for forever, and he took it real serious to the extent where there's only a few guys who will really, you know, when you're with them, they won't sign autographs. They genuinely tell kids to go screw themselves.
Yeah.
You know, and they'll do it in and outside the ring. And so this guy named Bully Ray, he used to be part of 3D, the Dudley Boys, the bigger one of those two. He's legit heel.
Yeah, they get method with it.
Yeah.
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 What's your favorite cereal?
I don't eat cereal.
What?
But, no, I don't. Never. But if I had it, like, man, I think, you know, every once in a while I'll stay at like a Holiday Inn Express and I'll have something like Apple Jacks or something. And I think that's the last time I tried something sweet like that. And maybe, you know, that's like a little kid's treat.
What about when you were a kid? Did you eat cereals?
Man, I remember 7 kids in a Mormon family. We were lucky to have Cheerios.
No kidding. That's true.
Yeah. Yeah.
Did you have a favorite children's show?
No.
Okay.
I just don't.
Yeah.
I don't. Unfortunately, I don't. I'm sorry about that one.
That's okay.
I'll say Power Rangers because it's martial arts, but is that a kid show?
Yeah, I guess. Sure.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, okay. I mean, it's definitely more for kids than it is adults.
Okay.
This one might be too easy, but favorite Jack Black movie?
Nacho Libre, yeah. Yeah, I was very, very lucky to get to train him for that. And then about halfway through, he said, hey, I'd really like you to come and work with me and be the villain, be the bad guy, because I'm real comfortable working with you. And then he gives me the script, and it's a guy named Ramses, and I don't fit it in any way, shape, or form. For starters, I'm all tatted up, and he's supposed to be this like Mexican wrestler, you know, and he's looks a certain way, and I've got, you know, green eyes and everything. And so they had me go into the studio and read for Jared and Jaressa Hess, the people who wrote the movie.
Yeah.
And because Jack had given me the nod, they were nice as could be, but I was like, this doesn't make a drop of sense. So we're all set to go to Oaxaca, Mexico. And about 2 weeks before, Jack breaks the news to me that they got a guy that is a guy named Silver King who looked the part. And I mean, perfect for it. You know,
yeah.
I read the sides and I couldn't do the accent well. The whole thing was off, just not right. But they were kind enough to pay me the base amount that I would have made for going to Lock and Stone. Yeah.
Well, that's nice.
Yeah.
Which is unheard of in Hollywood.
Yeah, absolutely. Do you do late night snacks? And if so, what's your favorite late night snack?
Man, late night snacks. I'm not a big late night snack guy. I mentioned I used to be a big drinker. And so I used to drink cocktails late at night, like vodka sodas. But I stopped drinking, and I stopped eating. So no, I don't do either one now.
But when you did, it was a late night cocktail.
When I did, it was just whatever man.
Came.
Yeah. There wasn't any limits. It's a mushy blur.
That the alcohol stimulates your desire it to sure eat does. All yeah, sorts of stuff.
Everything.
Yeah. Well, and I wouldn't eat much during the day. I mean, my wife would be like, you never eat, you know? And I'm like, well, I get my calories in other ways.
The last one in the dish, what's your favorite place for a vacation?
Well, so this one's going to be a toss-up because I have four places that I've gone that I love to death. Jamaica is incredible. Cape Town, South Africa, amazing. We're gonna go Thailand, and last but not least, we're gonna go Mexico, Cancun. Awesome. Cancun.
Yeah.
So I can't say one of those because there's such different type of places that. You know, but those would be my four favorite. I don't know.
Excellent.
How do you pick one of those?
That's true. I know. Yeah, just pick one.
They don't. You're not the bad guy anymore when you're in Mexico. They don't recognize you.
No, they don't. Good. They don't. Thank good. Goodness.
There goes that son of a bitch right there.
I know.
Well, we've been served. Thank you, Tommy. Appreciate it. All right. Well, thanks so much for joining us, Tommy. That was awesome. What can we? Is there anything that we can plug and things coming up for you guys in the future? And it's a little different. Like most of the guests that we have on there, like have an album coming out or something. But
yeah, no, I don't have any albums coming out. I am working on a book that I'll be, probably finishing. It'll be 6 months or a year away. But
like I'm a biography writing, or something?
Yeah. Just memoirs. Cool. And it's just this is a lot of fun details of all this stuff. So I've been working on that. My wife, whose name is Zoey Stark, is one of the top women's wrestlers. Actually, one of the top wrestlers overall in the world. Wow. She's on TV every Monday night on Raw. And she will be facing Rhea Ripley for the championship belt. When? Saturday.
Oh,
where? Yes.
Where? Chicago.
Oh, awesome.
We're going from here to Utah, and hopefully we see you there for Turkey Day. Are you guys going to be around?
Yeah, we will be
around.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hopefully we see you there, and then we come back and go out and do Chicago and all that good stuff.
Oh, man, it was such a pleasure. I hope we do get to see you. Yeah, we'll be here. We're having the Turkey Day at our house. This episode's going to air Wednesday night, the Wednesday right before Thanksgiving. So thanks. It was so great having you here with us. Not just because I haven't seen you forever and I love you. You're your family. But
yes.
But the things you've done in your lifetime and the things you're still doing are inspirational. So
thank you, man. I'm very proud of you too. You guys both. And I'm dying to see your kids. They're probably not even kids anymore, are they?
They're not. They're like...
They are.
They're adults that treat me like I'm a child.
Isn't that funny? We become the children.
15 and 17.
It's true. We do totally become the children. All right. Well, good luck at the match, Teresa. And because I imagine she's off to the side there. Thanks, Tom, for joining us. And we'll talk to you soon. Have a great rest of the day today.
Love and miss you guys, and we'll see you soon. Take care.
Okay. Bye. Bye.
Bye.
Okay, there we go. We'll get out of here. But that was really nice, and Tom's really good at giving explanation about what, you know, the, yeah. his answer. He's always been really good at that.
No, he's a great person.
Do you have anything else?
Nope.
I wasn't going to go.
Happy Thanksgiving to those who are in America, I guess.
Yeah. All right. Well, there you go.
Hey, goodbye.
That's it from us here. Thanks to Tommy.
Yeah, thanks.
I mean, growing up, his name was Tommy, so I don't...
I know, I call him Tommy.
Yeah, but I don't know if, like, you know, like some people when they were growing up, their name was Sammy, but then as they get older, they feel like, that people were calling me Sammy. My name's Sam. I'm not a little kid anymore.
I still call Sam Sammy.
I'm just saying, dude, does that happen? Is it now Thomas? Or is...
It just depends on the person and their personality. Because yeah. We know one friend... It was like, I am no longer this, I am now this.
And it was very much to do with that, like,
I am no longer
that's a little kid's, that's a...
Richie, I am Richard.
Yeah, it was very much that. That's what I'm wondering. Is that happen? Is that normal? I mean, not normal, but...
You have more friends than I do. That's just not a good question.
And none of this is making any sense to anyone as they're listening. All right, everybody, we're getting out of here. ArtByTai.com, DOD45.com. You'll hear it at the end. Thank you so much. Happy Thanksgiving, everybody. Oh, you know what I do need to say? There are some episodes coming up. Taryn Manning is an episode coming up. Lisa Wallen's an episode coming up. Our next episode is... Mugs and Pockets, that's coming up, and we're gonna have a whole bunch of different things outside of the hip hop world, so that's probably good for some people and not so good for other people. All right, we're out of here. Thanks for joining us. We out here. Peace.
DOD45.
Thank you for joining in on yet another episode of the DOD45 show. Please hit the subscribe or follow button so that you never miss an episode. You can even go one step further by leaving us a review on the YouTube stream or on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or wherever it is that you stream our show from. You can find me at ArtByTai on all the socials or at ArtByTai.com. And if you'd like to follow the DOD45 show on social media, we're at DOD45W on Instagram, or you can go over to our website at DOD45.com where you can shoot us an email, join our mailing list, and watch all of our past episodes. Consider joining us for a live chat on the YouTube premieres of episodes every Wednesday night at 8 p.m. Eastern. Peace.